Dr. DeBakey, we're doing this interview in anticipation of the 50th anniversary of the Society for Vascular Surgery. You were one of the two remaining founding members, and we're interested in your appraisal of how Society for Vascular Surgery came about. I believe it was 1946 that you had your organizational meeting.
Right. Well, it came about to some extent because of the war experience. As you know, during the war, during World War II, there was a very high incidence of amputations from major arterial injuries in the extremities, both the upper and lower extremities. So that vascular repair, was not very successful. But that actually was not successful because it wasn't tried very much. And you may recall that Simeone and I did an analysis of arterial injuries during World War II, in which we published our experience showing a very high incidence of lack of doing vascular surgery. However, vascular surgery became sort of important in these vascular injuries subsequently in the patients who developed arteriovenous fistulae. And we had, we set up what we call vascular centers. Dan Elkin was head of one of them, as a matter of fact, in the Greenbrier area. And Harry Schumacher was assigned to one of them in Indiana. So we had to set up these centers immediately at the end of the war to take care of the wounded that came back. And in order to concentrate the personnel, because we were short on personnel, highly trained personnel, especially people trained in these specialties like neurosurgery, orthopedics, vascular surgery, and so on.
Well, now people hadn't really trained in vascular surgery.
No, that's right.
You were involved in encouraging people, I guess,
exactly. But we were concentrating the vascular problems in what we call the vascular centers. And as I say, a large part of the vascular surgery was arteriovenous fistulae. These are the people who survived, you see, but they had a little arteriovenous aneurysm had to be repaired. And so this stimulated the idea that vascular surgery should be a kind of a specialty. It wasn't then at all. But that concept developed out of the military experience and the establishment of these centers. So Dan Elkin, Harry Schumacher, for example, led one of these centers. A fellow by the name of Ross in Washington was interested in it. And another fellow by the name of George Lilly in Florida. George Lilly had worked with Dr. Oxnard. As a matter of fact, when I was a resident, George was my immediate superior as one of the assistants on the faculty. So I got to know him very well. He hadn't been in the military, but he got interested in it. And at a meeting of one of the, I've forgotten whether it was.
Should have been the AMA, I think.
Yeah, I think it was one of the meetings like that. We got together and talked about this. And as you know, it's often very difficult where the discussion develops, where everybody's interested in the same field. They said, well, why don't we sort of organize a society? And they asked me if I would prepare a kind of a constitution and bylaws, you see. And I did. And I think, if I remember, Ross or George were the first secretaries, and later Harry became the secretary. And over the next few years, we met and gradually increased the number of people involved, and the society sort of took off.
Well, now, the International Cardiovascular Society existed at that time, didn't it? And what was the issue of when having a joint meeting with them?
The International Surgical Society existed. The International Cardiovascular Society came later.
Oh, it did?
Yeah. And was organized subsequently under the auspices of the International Surgical Society. And I'm not sure, but I'd have to go back to my records. I believe either Lariche or Fontaine, who was his professor of Agrégé, I think maybe Fontaine, was Fontaine and a fellow by the name of Italian surgeon, Milan, were the two driving forces in that organization.
I see.
But well, we preceded them.
Now, the meetings were held at the time of the AMA, I believe. Weren't they held
originally,
at the junction?
Yeah. Originally.
Well, what was the reason for that?
Largely because the surgical segment of the AMA was the was one of the major meeting places, sort of for the national meeting for surgeons. At that time, the surgery section was very well led. You remember, in those days, people like Fred Rankin, Elvis Graham, Elton Oxer were chairman of the surgical sections of the AMA. It was only later that the surgical part of the AMA really lost that kind of prestige.
I see.
Because, to a large extent, because of the American College of Surgeons.
What do you remember about those initial meetings? Do you remember anything about the programs or how programs were organized?
Yeah, the programs were really organized mostly by the secretary. And he would call upon various people to make presentations. And then they began some lab work, you see, so that they could come and bring their experiences. By 49 or 50, there was a considerable amount of lab work on arterial prostheses, beginning with homographs. And then the interest was in how do you preserve homographs, you see. And we went to freezing, you know, process for preservation. I said, I've got homographs right now, still sealed in big glass cases, frozen, you know, dried up in there. And then shortly after that, I think about 51, something like that, Voorhees in New York initiated the concept with the use of prostheses by his experimental work with Vignon N. And so a lot of us began doing experimental work with various types of grafts. And Zoology, for example, and Harry Schumacher, and I, and a number of others, Sterling Edwards, would come and make our presentations and exchange information at the meetings. So it became lively, you see. And then we began, you remember, I'm trying to remember whether it was 46, when Kuhnlein did published his first bypass, femoropopsial bypass. You know, in that connection, you may be interested in this. About 1915, something like that, a German by the name of Jaeger, J-A-G-E-R, a young fellow, wrote a book on vascular surgery. He became interested in vascular surgery. He came to this country, and he traveled about, and he saw, it was at the Rockefeller Institute. Did the early work, got the Nobel Prize for his suturing of vessels. Name's on the end of my tongue. But anyway, it doesn't matter. Anyway, he traveled and he saw him work. He saw a few other labs at that time that were, and of course there were a few. The one here in Chicago, Murphy, for example, here in Chicago, was doing some experimental work.
Were you referring to Correll's work?
Correll, that's what.
I assumed he phased out the turn of the century, but was he still working in 1915?
No, he was working in about 1910, 1911. He was at his height then. I think it was very close when he got the Nobel Prize about 1910, 11, 12, something like that. And that's when this fellow was coming. The reason that I gave you the date of 1915, something like that, was he went into the war. He was in World War One, and matter of fact, he died in World War One, died of typhus. But in that book, he describes a bypass. He never did it. He never did it experimentally. He describes all the experimental work he did a lot of experimental work. in vascular surgery. And he has a drawing in which he tells about the concept. And he says, this is the bypass concept may be a way to restore circulation beyond the blocked area.
That'd be darn. Was Cunlin aware of that work?
No. He wasn't aware of it.
Was that kind of buried, I guess?
It was buried because it was published only in that German book. He didn't publish it in a journal. I got a copy of that book. That's how I found out about it. Matter of fact, I translated the book. And at some point, I may get a publishing version of it. But it's a very interesting book in that sense, that even at that time. So he deserves credit for the concept. He never did it. But Cunlin did it and published it. And of course, as soon as that came out, then the idea of a bypass, you see, was available to everybody who was interested in the field. So by 1951, we were doing bypasses. And then you remember Dos Santos came out with what he called desobliteration, remember? Which later became endarterectomy. And you remember that was serendipity, because he was trying to remove a thrombus in the femoral artery, a fresh thrombus. Well, it's fresh, but it was firm. And in doing so, he found a cleavage plane between the lesion, you see the clot was attached to the atheromatous process, and all of a sudden he found this cleavage plane, very nice cleavage plane, you see. And that's why he called it disobliteration, you see, which later was translated. Actually, it was translated endarterectomy by one of the French people. I forgot whether it was Fontaine or Cunlin. Anyway, they later published it as endarterectomy. So that came into being. So by 51 and 52, we began doing bypasses and endarterectomy. And that's when the society really took off. Because, you know, all of these fellows. And there was about, I would say, 25 or 30 by that time who were very active in the field. There was a fellow out in the California area whose name...
Norman Freeman,
Norman, I think. Freeman, oh. That's right. He was very active.
Yeah.
Yeah. A little bit crazy, too.
That's right. That's his
he
only
had,
problem.
You know, he had a brother here in Washington, not here, but I mean in Washington, who was a psychiatrist who did I think he was one of the first to do lobotomy. So he had a little nuttiness in the family.
Yes, Norman was responsible for establishing UC San Francisco's vascular.
That's right. Yeah, so, I was very fond of Norman. I liked him very much. He was full of ideas, some of which were a little bit nutty, but he was charming.
Well, now the Holman's lecture was established.
That's right.
In that period also.
Holman's lecture and the Mattis medal. And then later, the Lorish Medal for the International was established, which, of course, simulated also, you know, was a stimulus for vascular surgery. So we began to develop more and more interest. But I would say that from a technical standpoint, you see, you had to have something technical to really take off. From a technical standpoint, I would say those two procedures, the bypass and endarterectomy, but more importantly, was arteriography, because it was with the arteriogram that you were able to isolate the lesion and to actually see the arterial bed and determine that there was a good normal arterial bed beyond the block, which made the bypass, of course, readily applicable. And one of the first articles that I published, that was one of the things I pointed out. And so I feel that arteriography, the development of the homograft to bridge vessels, and for that I think Gross and Hufnagel deserve a lot of credit, particularly Hufnagel, because he did primarily, in a way, he was in the lab with Gross and he was doing the lab work. And Hufnagel, I think, deserves a great deal of credit for that. And he, by the way, Hufnagel also participated in the early development of the society. Not in its founding, but he came in right afterwards.
Now, Rene Fontaine, I think, was one of your first Hohmann lecturers.
That's right.
Is that correct?
Rene Fontaine was the professor agrégé, as they call it, associate professor, under Larisse in Strasbourg, when I was there as a fellow. And when Larisse moved from Strasbourg to the College of Paris, you know, which was, you know, one of the great professorships in France, Fontaine became head of that clinic. And Fontaine was really got into vascular surgery through sympathectomy. Yeah.
Well, that was the only arterial operation, really, wasn't it, in that era?
Yeah.
About all you could do was improve.
Exactly. And of course, you know, that's really why I went to Larisse's clinic, to spend a year with him, because he was a leading proponent for sympathectomy.
I want to come back to that later, but let's go on regarding your experience in the SVS. You were the seventh president of the SVS. We can't find your presidential address. Is that, was that ever published?
Yeah, sure.
It was.
I'll send it to you.
All right. Now, what was that on?
It was on our early experience with aneurysms and occlusive disease. I have a reprint of it.
Well, were the papers presented to the Society routinely published in that era?
They were not. Because we didn't have a journal. If you remember, the articles that were presented there were submitted first to surgery. And the reason for that was because Dr. Oxner and Wang Yixing were the editors of surgery. And they had started this new journal, you see. And of course, in starting a new journal, they were looking for other papers coming from other sources, scientific papers, because they had to compete with the journals that already existed, like the Annals, you see, archives. And so we immediately went to them, and we would submit the papers to them. But we didn't have a contract with them to publish all of our papers or to publish transactions. You see, that came later.
You remember what year Journal of Surgery started?
The Journal of Vascular Surgery.
No, yeah, the Journal of Surgery.
I think it started in...
It was after World War II.
I think it started, yes, it started, I think, in 46 or 47, 48, something like that.
About the time the society started.
That's right. That's right. Yeah. But that's, one of our weaknesses. We talked about that. What's the possibility of a journal? And if you may recall, the Europeans have, you know, preceded us in developing a journal. But we had this relationship with surgery early, and so we had difficulty to get out of it, really. And where were we going to go if we got out of it? So that's why we were stuck, you see.
So the discussion.
But they really did a pretty good job. I would say that something on the order of about maybe 60 to 70% of the articles that were presented at the meeting were published.
Well, now, obviously you were involved in starting the Journal of Vascular Surgery, but that came many, many years after.
Oh, yeah, that came much later.
And that's a relatively modern history from the standpoint of the organization. Where do you think the organization is going in the future? Do you think vascular surgery, have we solved all the problems in vascular surgery? Is there...
Oh, no, not by any means.
What are those...
Just think for a moment, Bill, from your own experience. Arteriosclerosis, we use that term. I have a different concept, but not many people agree with me. But arteriosclerosis, or let's say arterial occlusive disease and arterial aneurysmal disease, for the most part, are of unknown origin. No matter what the so-called, what I call the cholesterol mafia people say, the fact remains that we don't know the cause. And until we know the cause, we're not going to have any effective means of preventing it. So the disease is going to continue. You've got an increasingly older population in all industrial countries. And we know that many of these diseases are also a function of time. To be sure, people, young people can have these diseases, but as you know, the great majority will develop it after they're 50 and all the way up to 80. And we're seeing more and more people in their late 60s and 70s and even 80s that we're operating on now, which 10 years, 15, 20 years ago, we wouldn't think of operating on. So we have an expanded market. So vascular surgeons, I think, as far as I'm concerned, for the future, have an expanding role. There's no question about it. But we're going to have to continue innovative developments in order to advance the field, even technically. And they are, I think, doing it to some extent.
Yeah, what do you think about the interventional radiologists and minimal access surgery and so forth? What's their potential in all of this?
Well, I think that vascular surgeons should take control of it for a number of reasons. First, they're the best equipped, both conceptually, and I think this is very important, Bill, and technically, because, you know, most people who aren't in the field regards surgery as a kind of a technical exercise. But as you know, the conceptual part of surgery is the driving force for the technical exercise. And if the technical exercise is really going to be effective and successful and useful, it's going to have to be based upon a good concept. And so the vascular surgeon has that. He's got the conceptual background to deal with this kind of a problem. And these kinds of interventions have risks associated with them. And those risks can only be taken care of by someone who has the conceptual capability of dealing with the risks technically, you see? So I think it still belongs in the field of vascular surgery, and I think the vascular surgeon should maintain control. Now, to do so, I think they're going to have to either be in control of the radiological equipment or of the radiologist who's going to work with them. Otherwise, you're going to have a competition between radiologists and surgeons, and if the radiologist controls the radiology equipment, he's going to be able to keep the surgeon out of it. If he works with him and they work together, utilizing the equipment together, then it can be successful. But I do think that the vascular surgeons must be aggressive about it. And if the radiologist doesn't agree with them, they're going to have to find a way to get their own radiological equipment, just like they get if they're going to do like those that are interested in laparoscopic work, get their own monitoring equipment, and even radiological equipment, and even scanners on their own, they bring right into the operating room. In other words, the surgeon must be in control of what he does. If he needs a heart-lung machine, he brings it in the operating room. He doesn't have a perfusionist telling him what he can do with it. He's got to be in control.
How about minimally access vascular surgery?
I know there have been some publicity about minimal access coronary bypass, for example. And I can recall, you know, in our very early days, we didn't stop the heart except later for doing LADs, for example. We did endarterectomy on the LAD with the heart beating. You can do an anastomosis, particularly the right coronary, very easily. Can't do it. I don't think a minimal access would provide the means of doing an anastomosis of the obtuse marginal. You can't do it through a minimal access. You got to bring the heart up. You got to have a good exposure to do so. I think there is a place for some forms of minimal access, but I don't think it's going to be possible to deal with the let's say, the larger part of the field at all. And in the final analysis, we're improving our techniques all the time. You know, our average hospital stay for a coronary bypass right now is 5 days in the hospital. Minimal access is not going to prove that very much.
What about
it limits you see. Minimal access will limit the field. It limits, you can't do 4 or 5 bypasses with a minimal access. That's what I mean. So it has a place. In the same way with endovascular types of procedures, I think that there again, the vascular surgeons must take control of it. And they must perfect it. And there's no question it will have a place. But there has to be very thorough research protocols that will deal with the problem in a scientific manner. And I think this is there is some of that going on, but there are there's still some part of it that isn't very scientifically being developed.
What about cardiac and vascular surgery? Are they destined to separate completely in separate specialties? How do you feel
about
that?
Well, my philosophy of that has long been that the cardiovascular system is a sort of a united system. And I think it's a mistake to separate the heart from the rest of the vascular system. And my philosophy is that the cardiovascular system should remain intact. And if you look at it from a clinical standpoint, the cardiovascular work is dependent upon diseases that involve the aorta and the 4 major arterial beds of the body, the coronary system, the branches of the aortic arch, the abdominal visceral vessels, celiac, supramedullary, and renal, and the peripheral vascular in the lower extremities, so the distal abdominal aorta and branches. Well, when a patient comes in with a lesion in any of these areas, we know from our experience that we will study that patient. If he comes in with a lesion of the renal artery, we want to know what his cardiac status is. So we study him. We may not do a coronary arteriogram, that may not be necessary, but we will study him enough to know that he's got a good heart.
We're on the subject of whether cardiac and vascular separate specialties. There's a practical problem, Dr. DeBakey, with your concept, and that is one trains in cardiac surgery or one trains in vascular surgery. And so far, we haven't melded that too much. The cardiac surgeons certainly feel comfortable by the basis of their training with thoracic vascular procedures, but there's the issue of the peripheral vascular aspects of surgery.
Well, there's no question about it. There is a problem with it. And my concept is not very popular right now. And that's evidenced by the fact that you now have boards that separate the two. I just happen to think that was a mistake. There was nothing I could do about it at the time except express my opinion, but the opinion of the majority was that they wanted a board in vascular surgery. And that separated it. Now, when I was head of the department, I continued to maintain my concept and philosophy of cardiovascular disease, even though I established a residency program in vascular surgery, largely to meet the needs of the board. But I still think that from an overall standpoint, if the center is well organized, cardiovascular center is well organized and well led, the fact that there are separate in people who are working in the vascular field and the cardiac field may not make that great a difference if they're working together, if it's a well-integrated center, you see. Because even in our place, we had individuals who were more interested in vascular area than they were in cardiac. I happen to like all of them. but I think what I'm saying is, again, I come back to the concept. because I think the concept in surgery, conceptual consideration in surgery, constitutes a very important basis for the expression of the technical aspects and in taking care of the patient. If you take care of the patient, you want to know all about him. If you're going to concentrate on just one aspect of him and disregard the other aspect, you're not going to give him the best possible care. And you're not going to reduce your risk in dealing with his care by in a sense, conceptually looking at him as a unified system of cardiovascular problems, you're able to deal with it much better. And I've, you know, in my own experience, and I'm sure you've had this experience too, and any vascular surgeon, cardiovascular surgeon will have this experience, have patients referred to you, and you pick up lesions they didn't see, they didn't observe, you see? You pick up lesions that are significant. You know, patients are referred to me for, let's say, a coronary bypass, and then I find that they've got a 95% stenosis, and when you ask, you know, question the patient more closely, you find he's had a TIA. Well, then you realize, you know, if you're going to put him under an anesthetic, do his coronary bypass, you take a chance of getting a stroke with him. So, I mean, just as an illustration of what I mean, that concept, I think, is important. That's what I mean.
Okay. Let's diverge here and ask you comment on the role of the Lifeline Foundation.
Well, the Lifeline Foundation, I think, was extremely important because the society now has a role in helping to in a sense, advance and some sort of direct research, because by that means it has the money to do so. And that's extremely important for several reasons. One is that the NIH, which is a major source of research in this country, has gradually, over a period of time, reduced the support for clinical research. Now that was almost a natural development, because as the basic scientists began to develop more and more, and then to control the study sections, you know, at one time we had a surgery study section that was virtually eliminated, and with the decrease in funding in relation to the number of grant applications, for example, now they are only able to fund something like 13% of approved grants. So the funding, the national funding, so to speak, research funding, for research in the clinical field, and cardiovascular surgery is a clinical field, virtually dried up.
What is your perception of the role of industry support of surgical research?
Well, no, industry should, but you got to keep in mind that the industry also has its own agenda. And let's say pharmaceutical industry, for example, they put in quite a money into research, but they're trying to research new drugs. The other particular industry we're dealing with, of course, is the device industries. And I think they certainly owe some obligation to support research in this field. But the Lifeline, you see, creates a mechanism by which you can put a little pressure on them. And in a sense, stimulate them to do so. So I think the Lifeline Foundation was a great idea, and I think it's extremely important for the future of vascular surgery.
What do you think the future of vascular surgery, or how it will be affected by managed care? Now, if I were running a managed care operation faced with increasing longevity, I would do everything I can to keep patients out of the hands of vascular surgeons.
And that's
cheaper to let them die than it is to...
Oh, yes, you know, it doesn't cost very much to let a patient die. There's no question that is already affecting vascular surgery right now. And the effect is going to depend in the future upon the growth and expansion of managed care. And as I see it, I think that it will grow and expand over the next, I'd say, 2 or 3 or 4 years. Right now, across the country, managed care probably has control of about 20-25% of the population. In some states, like California, it has a higher percentage. But they are aggressively pursuing it, even after going after Medicaid and Medicare patients, which is ironical in a way, because we all know that to take care of a Medicare or Medicaid patient, you lose money, and yet they're going after them. So it's obvious they're making money out of not giving them care. But in time, I think that the public will become disillusioned with us, and the pressure will be that, and I would guess in 4 or 5 years, you're going to see some of these managed care people go bankrupt, because they're going to be forced to take care of patients and they haven't got the money to do it. See, right now, they're able to fool the people, but they can't do that all the time. So I think in time, we're going to get over it, but it's going to take 4 or 5 years.
One of the issues, question on solution to Medicare budget, obviously, if you're going to take care of an increasing geriatric population, it's going to get progressively more expensive.
That's right.
And you're going to be trying to save people who are no longer productive and throwing the burden on those who are. Is there any solution to that that you can see?
Well, that's a societal problem and a big one. There's no question about it. And I don't know the answer to that. My feeling in general is I'm really not too, let's say, gloomy about it. I'm more optimistic about it for this reason. In general, if you look back over the history of the American society, as I see it, the societal characteristics of the American people, the American people are compassionate. And when it comes to the need, they'll volunteer some way. Invariably, they've come through. So I think that that society will find a solution to this problem. How it will do so, I don't know, because I don't have my own, I don't have a solution. But I think it will. I think that we'll find a way to do it. We're going to have to come to some kind of national insurance. My great concern about national insurance, of course, is that it not be government dominated, because there's hardly anything, and I ask this question to some of my friends, can you think of anything that the government does that is done with excellence and is superior? You see? And they can't cite one thing. And that's perfectly understandable, because when the government does it, it does it with some kind of bureaucracy. And from your own experience, even in our own institutions, when the bureaucracy gets involved, we have problems. Years ago, just to digress just for a moment, in the mid-60s, President Johnson asked me to chair a commission which was called the Commission on Heart Disease, Cancer, and Stroke. And out of that, We proposed the idea of what we call the regional medical program. And I still think that's a very good concept. Briefly, what it involved was to establish within a given region, population region, say 500,000 or 1 million population, you had one center for that population that was able to do all the tertiary work. And all the tertiary work would go there, to that one center. So all, say, coronary bypasses, all endarterectomies would go there, and other neurosurgical and orthopedic and so on, that needed to require highly specialized technical work. By concentrating it, you'd do it more efficiently and better. And in that population, all the people had the ability to go there and get their care, if they couldn't pay for it, free, because you would subsidize the center. And at that time, we said that we would subsidize it if I remember correctly, something around $15 to $20 million a year. Now it would cost more. But that might be a much cheaper way of dealing with it, you see. In the meantime, you would, of course, have some insurance to take care of the routine problems, particularly for the workers and those who could afford it. In that, also that population, you would have outreach clinics and maybe a few hospitals that would do sort of secondary procedures like hernia operations and simple procedures. You see? And that, to me, is still an effective solution to the problem.
Let's get on to some personal questions. What do you consider your greatest triumph?
You know, I've been asked that question before. I don't know. I have to leave that to others. But I'll tell you what I sort of treasure most in my heart are people like you that I've had an opportunity to influence. And I guess that comes from the same feeling you get about your children. If your children do well, you just take great pride. And I guess in a way it's kind of an ego thing for you. You get the feeling that maybe you did something worthwhile. And I think that, you know, I've had so many wonderful people like you yourself who have come under my influence and have done so well, and I'm so proud of them. I think I get more pleasure personally out of that. You naturally, when you look back, you know, and you think of your first case that was successful, first coronary bypass that was successful, the first aneurysm of thoracic aorta removed that was successful, you know, you get some gratification out of that. But it's not a lasting thing. At the time, it was gratifying, and in the sense you're glad you were able to do it. But I think a more lasting gratification comes from people who are living and that you have influenced.
Do you have any estimate of the number of fellows that you've trained?
Yeah, the last estimate I had was given to me by Arthur Bell, and Ken Malik, who keep a record of it. And they told me it was something like 1,000, you know, throughout the world.
That's amazing. What would you consider your greatest disaster defeat, if you would?
Well, there's a lot of things I would do differently if I'd had the experiences. You know, we all learn from experience, so we all make mistakes. I don't know. I think if I had to go back over my life, I'd want to do pretty much what I did. If I'd had the experience, I wouldn't have made some of the mistakes I made. But I've not had any disastrous experience, as far as I know. It's hard for me to think of anything that was really disastrous.
In terms of development of the Dacron graft, what would be the impact of the FDA now as you try to introduce a prosthesis like that?
If we had to develop the Dacron graft the way we developed it then, I'm not sure we would have it today with the way they regulate things. And I'll give you a good illustration. Let's go back to that time. As I told you, Boris was certainly my inspiration for going in, and others too. And I began to work in the laboratory, actually making out of sheets of, at that time, Dacron. And I've told this story before, you may remember. When I went down to the department store to get some vignon and cloth, they didn't have any. And so I said, well, do you have nylon? They said, well, fresh out of nylon, but we have a new one called Dacron. So I felt it and looked at it. It looked pretty good to me. So I bought a yard of it. And you've got to remember that my mother was a kind of a sewing instructress. In those days, when I was growing up as a boy, girls were supposed to learn to sew. And so after school, she'd always have about six or seven young girls come to the house, and she spent about an hour with them teaching them how to sew. And I sat there with them, you know, and she saw I was interested, so she taught me to sew. In fact, I taught my wife to sew. So I had this sense of what you could do with a sewing machine, with a pattern, for example, when you want to cut a pattern for a dress or a shirt or something, I can do that. So I took the snake around a yard of it, and I cut it in the width I wanted, two sheets, and sewed the edges on each side and made a tube out of it, you see. Later on, we made our own crinking, and Sterling Edwards deserves the credit for that. That's where I got the idea from Sterling. We put it on a stent, you know, and then take a nylon thread and wrap it around that like that, and then push it together. and we'd bake it, and that would change the memory in the fiber, and then it would crink, you see. And we did that all ourselves in the laboratory. So after about 2 or 3 years of laboratory work, I decided that was, you know, it was very successful. We had patency, good patency of the grafts in the dogs. I said, it was time to put it in a human. And on my own, I didn't have a committee to approve it or anything. And in 1954, I made a bifurcation graft of the size I wanted for a human, made several different sizes, so I had them available. They weren't crimped either. And in 1954, I put the first one for an abdominal aortic aneurysm resection. That first fellow lived, I think, 13 years. Never had any trouble with this. Died of a heart attack from Oklahoma. I followed him. Well, today, to show you the difference, in 1983, I went to the Bard people and said, look, I'd like to get you to make these albumin-coated grafts, because we were doing it in the operating room for patients upon whom we would, say, do a resection where we, of the ascending aorta, just an example, where you'd heparinize a patient. We'd take this Dacron graft, you know, immerse it in albumin that you use for intravenous use, and then bake it a little bit. And that would seal it. And that's what I wanted them to do, Bard Company, because they were making my Dacron grafts. So they did. The first year that they did this, they sealed it in sort of saline solution. But the manufacturing process was so involved that they said, let's stop for a while and see if we can do it some different way. So I said, all right. But they came back the year later, and I think in 86, 87, we started again. And we had to go to the FDA. They insisted upon us going through the whole damn process. Now here we were, you know, the Dacron graft had been used for over 30 years. Albumin intravenously had been used for over 40 years. Both, well, you know, great experiences, no problems. When we put them together, they decided we had to go through a whole new process. We had to even do experimental work. We did in dogs, in which we identified the albumin and had to demonstrate, for example, what happened to it. Well, it was absorbed. In 6 weeks or so, it was completely absorbed. So you were left with the same graft. It took us nearly 10 years to get, finally got approved just last year. In the meantime, it was approved all over the world. It was being used everywhere except here. So that gives you some idea of what you'd have to go through. Think of what you'd have to go through then. There's no question that it is holding back technical developments. And, you know, many of the pharmaceutical companies go abroad to do their clinical work.
Where do you think the Society of Vascular Surgery is going to be 100 years from now? Do you think
it will depend to a large extent upon research in the circulatory field primarily. If, for example, let's just use an illustration, we find a specific cause of arteriosclerosis, and we can have a vaccine, and you can vaccinate a child against arteriosclerosis, then a large part of vascular surgery will disappear. There will be, in my opinion, problems related to trauma, and probably some diseases that we will not have completely solved by that time. So I think that the cardiovascular field, because it's so critical to life and so essential to life, has to be maintained. And anything that interferes with it, we have to find a way to correct it. And the cardiovascular surgeons particularly are the ones best capable of doing so. So if research itself does not solve the problem, the need for cardiovascular surgery will still be there.
Might we think about incorporating some allies like our interventional radiologists into the society? Is that something you would welcome or be concerned about?
Well, I would think more in terms of incorporating them in the teamwork, you see. Then I think that by having them in the society is desirable. But to have them in the society as individuals who are members of the society, but who, when they go home, exclude the work or integration with the surgeon, then I think that doesn't work.
Now, let's start off on a different tack here. Dr. DeBakey, I'm curious about the background of your family, how they arrived in Louisiana, a little bit about your mother and father. Could you give us some information about them?
Well, my father and mother met in this country, of course. They both immigrated with their parents to the United States in the late 19th century. And you may or may not recall, see, they were Christians in the Lebanese community. And from time to time, the Christian people were very much of a minority in that area, which is very interesting when you think about it historically, because Christianity started there, but as you know, moved westward and left a very small sect, a Christian sect, that became a minority in the region. And it became a minority largely because Muhammad later, some 500 or 600 years later, really took over the people and made them all Muslims. But the small Christian group maintained their religious belief, much like the Jewish people did, their own, held on to it. But from time to time, they would be massacred. You know, there'd be wars. And my people, my parents, grandparents, really sort of immigrated to escape this oppression. Because they were able to speak French, and had participated in the teaching of French too. In you know, there was a French mission in that area, which was a Christian mission. They came to Louisiana through people in New York who said, we have business in Louisiana, but we need people who can speak French. And so that's how they settled in South Louisiana.
Did you find any prejudice? That South has a reputation for being the most prejudiced area of the country as being Lebanese?
Well, I must say, I never felt any prejudice as I growing up, even though I think there were only one other Lebanese family of Lebanese descent in the community. I never felt any prejudice or whatever. There was segregation among the whites and blacks at that time. We went to different schools, for example, even though we had a big backyard in our home, and very often after school or in the summertime particularly, we would play together, the black boys and us. We were, you know, we would play together, but we went to different schools. But there was no great sense of animosity at that time in the two groups. We had a large community of blacks in our small town. My father was a pharmacist, and ran two drug stores, the only two drug stores in the community. But he was also a sort of a businessman. And so I was very fortunate in the sense that he was highly successful. And even during the Depression, for example, I never suffered, even though many of my college classmates did suffer.
You've had some very successful siblings. Do you want to comment on your brother and your sisters?
Yes, I must say I'm proud of them too, because if you look in who's who in this country, you'll find my brother and my two sisters. If you look under the D's, you'll find four DeBakeys in a row in who's who.
I had occasion to meet your brother, and he has a remarkable resemblance.
He's my younger brother, of course. I'm the oldest in the family. And he trained with Everett Graham at St. Louis, and then came down and spent a year at charity under Dr. Oxer. Dr. Oxer tried to keep him when I left, but he had a very good offer to go and practice in Mobile. So he went on his own to Mobile. And he was very successful there.
We'd like to hear about your sisters.
Well, my sisters, you know, we all went to school at Tulane. I was the first to go, and then they all followed me. And we were good students. Some of the teachers said that as each one of us passed through, we got to be better students. So my sister, my youngest sister, Lois, was considered the best student in the family. You know, they were Phi Beta Kappas, and at Tulane, we had a girls' school called Sophie Newcomb, which was part of Tulane. And so they went there. And they were, you know, very good students. And and my youngest sister, Lois, Selma went to the Mayo Clinic to get training in medical editorial work. And they tried to keep her up there. I finally brought her down. But Lois was going to be a mathematician. And that's what she got a PhD in mathematics. Her second subject was English. And she called me after I'd moved, by that time I'd moved to Houston. And she said that she had taken all of the highest courses of mathematics they gave at Tulane, and she still wanted to be a mathematician. Was there any better or higher courses at Rice? So I called over there and found out they didn't. And then my further inquiries, I found that the best place for her was to come here, the University of Chicago. But I said, you know, why don't you consider a new career? By that time, computers were just beginning, and she had this, you know, mathematical background, and she knew statistical analyses, and then she had the English background. And I thought it was a good combination for someone who would help in editorial work and medical writing and medical research, and particularly in statistical analyses and so on. So I asked her, you know, if she'd consider that. And so she said, well, she'd think about it. In the meantime, she had an opportunity to work at Tulane doing some of the same thing. And they asked her if she'd like to do so. And I told her, I said, well, try it out and see if you like it. And she got, you know, very interested in it. And I finally persuaded her to come to Houston. So that's how they got started. And then in the meantime, Selma came back from Mayo Clinic, where she was in the editorial department there. And as you know, they have sort of made a career out of medical writing and teaching and instruction. You know, they've written books about it and so on. So
just looking at your CV, it's a full-time job, just keeping track of that. When did you decide to go into medicine? Was that early?
Well, you know, people have asked me that, and as far as I can remember, I wanted to go into medicine. I wanted to be a doctor. I think now, and trying to analyze it, it probably stemmed from, you see, I sort of grew up in a drugstore, a country drugstore. And in those days, the doctors very often hung around the drugstore because they'd come by to get their prescriptions and order the drugs they wanted, and sometimes pick up drugs that they were taking, because they were largely family practitioners.
You know, I thought the druggist practiced medicine.
Pretty much, you know. Oh, yes. And so I grew up in the drugstore with these doctors, and I admired them tremendously. Somehow or another, they appealed to me as being wonderful people. And so I thought, this is what I'd like to do, be a doctor. And from the time I started, I wanted to be a doctor. Now, after I got into college, you know, before I got into medical school, I had offers to go into other fields. For example, when I was in the Department of Zoology, actually, which at that time was kind of the biology department, the professor of zoology really became interested in me. And he asked me one day if I would like to assist him in the preparation of cat anatomy. And so I did. And I became sort of the technician. And we used to have a fellow that would go to the French market in New Orleans, you know, at night and pick up the roaming cats in a gunny sack. And he'd bring them to me, and I would chloroform them, you know, and then I would embalm them, and then I would start preparing them on a board for the students to do anatomy.
Well, is that how you got interested in surgery? Is that
that's part of it, I guess. Because anyway, he wanted me to stay in zoology. He said, in fact, he offered to send me to what's that famous biological center up in Maine on the coast, Cold Harbor or something like that. He wanted to send me up there one summer. I stayed in his department and for two summers doing work like that. They would have graduate students come to do graduate work in the summer, mostly school teachers who were working for an additional degree. And I assisted him in that. I used to go out, for example, in the swamps and catch frogs and snakes and so on. One occasion, I put them in a gunny sack. One occasion I came back, and this is in the summertime, you see, and I was staying in a rooming house, and it was a Sunday morning, and I went out there and got them, and I got back just in time for lunch. Well, I didn't have time to go to the lab and put them up, you see, and so I went in, I put them in the corner of the door when I came in. I just put them in the back of the door. And then I rushed in, washed my hands, and sat down for lunch, just in time for lunch. And a few minutes later, I saw some snakes coming into the dining room. Fortunately, they were benign. There weren't any moccasins in them. But boy, they saw them. You know, I got up, and they saw them, and the lady wanted to throw me out.
Well, now we got to get you into surgery.
What happened in surgery was when I got to be a junior medical student, Dr. Oxner took notice of me. And you remember he had also found out about my working with Dr. Mattis, I mean, by my translating articles for some of the faculty members, translating French and German.
Yeah, let's stop on that a moment. Well, you somehow got access to Mattis's library.
Well, some of the faculty members wanted to get a translation of some of the journals, articles that they were interested in, scientific articles. And at that time, much of the medical scientific material was in Europe. And so Dr. Mattis had the best library for foreign journals in his home on St. Charles Avenue. So our librarian, when I'd get the request from the doctors, the articles they want, I'd go to the librarian, and she'd send to his library. So one day when I went in to do the same thing, she said, "Dr. Baker, Dr. Mattis wants you to come over and get those yourself. He wants to meet you." He said, he called me, he said he wanted to know who this fellow was that was reading all his foreign journals. You know? So I went over to his house, and he met me at the door. Very courtly gentleman, really not very tall, a little rotund, had a goatee, And it was very, very pleasant to me. Sat me down and offered me a cup of port wine. And you know, I don't drink alcohol. And I was forced to drink it there because I couldn't possibly tell him I couldn't drink it. And even if it made me sick, I was going to drink it. Fortunately, it didn't have too much effect, because I just sipped a little bit. But he sat me down there, and he got my whole background and history. He wanted to know all about me. And from that point on, he really made me a friend. And of course, you know, I was greatly touched by all this. I mean, here, a medical student, and this, you know, this was a mythical man for me, Rudolf Mattis, you know. And he was so kind. He would invite me about, I would say, at least twice a month. He would invite me to dinner, and I enjoyed him tremendously.
Did he have anything to do with influencing your interest in vascular surgery?
I think he did have some influence. I think he did, because he was the one who suggested Lariche. Because when I said to Dr. Oxner that I'd like to go abroad and study, because you know Dr. Oxner had studied abroad, and he encouraged me to do that. And in those days, if you wanted to get anywhere academically, you really studied abroad.
Can we get you through your residency first?
My residency was at Charity Hospital. When I finished, by that time, of course, Dr. Oxner had taken me over, because he picked me up as a medical student in my junior year, and I got into the research laboratory that way. And when I was in his laboratory, some of the people in medicine found out about it and asked me to work for them in their laboratory too. So I had almost a full-time job in the laboratory as a technician. That's how I developed a roller pump. Not in Dr. Oxner's laboratory, but in the medical laboratory.
All right, well, tell us about that.
That came about because the fellow who was working, for whom I was working, the faculty member, was interested in the pulse wave. And he wanted to study modification of the pulse wave, you see. So he wanted to pump first to produce a pulse wave. That's what he said to me, find me a good pump for that purpose. So I went to the library, I went to the medical library, started looking up, you know, perfusion pumps. And there were some experimental perfusion pumps, but they were of no value for this purpose. They were for cells and things like that. So someone suggested to me that if I was interested in pumps, where to go was to the School of Engineering, because they had a lot of hydraulic pumps. And that's where I went and I researched hydraulic pumps, even went back as far as, it's very interesting too, because I went back historically to Archimedes, who, you know, invented the screw pump for irrigation purposes, and still be used in many places. And do you know today, that's the basis of the axial flow pump that I'm working with NASA on. It's really the same principle, the screw pump, Archimedes pump. Well, in the mid-19th century, rubber tubing came into being. And I found some articles on the use of rubber tubing to move fluid by compressing the tubing, you see? Not by a roller. That was my concept of rolling it. They compressed it with a compressor like that. They'd take the tube and fill it with fluid and put a valve on each side, what they call a flap valve, and then press it like that. And that's what gave me the idea. And I went down to the foundry in New Orleans and got them to make for me out of iron. And I watched them do it. You know, they put it in sand. They poured it in sand. And they made a kind of a bowl for me, you see, so I could roll the tube in there. What I found out, too, was that the tube would creep, you see. So you had to find a way to keep it from creeping. And that's when I put the flange on it, you see. Now, as you know, they do it much simpler by holding it. But the truth of the matter is, if you keep it from creeping, you'll produce less trauma to blood vessels than when you do it just by this method. We get by with it because the trauma during that short period of time is not great. Your hemoglobin that doesn't get up very high.
Well, how did you start using a transfusion? Obviously, you were designing for another.
The transfusion came later when I was a resident. At that time, we didn't have a blood bank. And if you wanted to give a transfusion, you had to do it direct. And Dr. Oxner had developed a technique when he was in Europe of using a glass, paraffin-coated glass tubing where they put the fresh blood in and then poured it and forced it by gravity into the artery.
Of course, you had no anticoagulant in that era, so that you had to have a means of...
See, there was an anticoagulant called Hirudin, which came, as you know, from the leeches, but it wasn't really available. So I became a sort of a transfusion expert, and I gave a lot of transfusions. By that time, of course, we had the types, so we could do cross matching, not as good as we can today, but enough to get by. And so we didn't have many reactions. And I gave a lot of transfusions that way, you know, with a hand pump.
Of course.
But what happened was that I was at a medical meeting, I think an AMA meeting, I think it was in St. Louis. The story is well told by John Gibbon himself in one of his articles. And he was showing his heart lung machine, an exhibit, with the cat. And he was describing it all to me, and he said we've got the oxygenator pretty well taken care of, but he said my pump didn't work well.
Well, now this was years later because your pump was designed in the 30s.
Oh yes.
And this was now
a
decade or more later.
Oh yeah, after the war. And I said to him, you know, at that meeting, why don't you try my pump? And I showed it to him. So I sent him a sample of it, you know, and that's when he adapted it to the heart-lung machine.
Well, now your pump had been phased out as a blood transfusion instrument by that time.
By that time,
Rumor had it that you had it somewhere in your basement or stored away.
Yeah, I gave it. That's what I did. I sent it to him. Yeah, well, that's how it came about.
Yeah, well, there's no question that he does credit you for the first
heart pump. He writes it up very, very well. But that's how it came about. See, I didn't start it with the idea of using a heart-lung machine. I used it for the heart-lung machine after I'd given it to Jack. And you know, after I moved to Houston, we started, like everybody else, started working with the heart-lung machine.
You want to comment on your residency experience at Charity Hospital?
Well, the residency experience at Charity Hospital was really a very pleasant one because, you know, we lived there. The residents lived in the hospital. And so we didn't come in and out. We were there 24 hours a day. Well,
that's what resident meant.
And it really meant that, and it was good. And as you know, the residencies that had residents living in the hospital were among the best in the country. And so I was working all the time, much as I could. And I would take the calls for some of the residents who wanted to go out, particularly on the weekend, you see. So I'd get a lot of extra work to do. So I was operating, you know, almost 18 hours a day. And so I had a great experience, really.
Well, you managed to publish some papers during that era, so you must have done some research.
Oh, yes, absolutely. Having grown up as a medical student in the research lab, even beginning, you know, with the anatomy lab, I became very much interested in research. And Dr. Oxner, you know, virtually forced it on me. I mean, he was a great researcher. And in time, you know, I took over his research lab. When I moved to Houston, I wasn't particularly, you know, desirous of moving, because I had everything I wanted right there. I had my own laboratory, and I was working in there all the time. And I got... As you know, once you get infected in research, this becomes a kind of a lifetime thing for you. So that's how that started.
Well, now, let's get back to the Lurie. When you finished your surgery residency, You made a decision to go to Europe.
Yeah, I made a decision. I wanted to go to Europe, just like Dr. Oxler. And I told Dr. Oxler, I said, you know, I'd like to have some experience in the circulatory field, which I was interested in. And sympathectomy was you know, Lurice was promoting sympathectomy for vascular diseases. And he said, well, let's ask Dr. Mattis what he thinks about it. So I went over to see him, you know. And he said, well, Lurice is the man you want. And he said, I know him well. I'll write him a letter. And he got the appointment for me. He wrote him a letter. Very interesting, too, because he also, and when I wanted to go to Germany, too. So, and Dr. Oxler, of course, had spent 2 years in Germany. He spent a year at Frankfurt and a year at Zurich in Switzerland. I'd say 1 year in Germany, 1 year in Switzerland. But the Swiss was a German section. And he was the one selected the Heidelberg experience.
Was that with Kirchner?
Kirchner, Martin Kirchner. If you remember the Kirchner wire.
Right.
That was a very interesting...
Could you compare the surgery in Germany with what you knew about the United States and German and French surgery of that era?
Well, I would say that the surgery that was done at that time, you would not regard today as being highly sophisticated surgery. With maybe the possible exception of Kirchner. Kirchner was a kind of a perfectionist. He did a lot of his work under local. It was very interesting, too, because the way he used local was interesting. He had a big tank where he had the local solution and a wire from that tank that came up to the ceiling and then came down just above the operating room. And he would connect to that tubing his sterile syringe with a little button on it that would release the fluid, you see. And the fluid was under pressure from another tank of, I think, if I remember correctly, was a tank of oxygen that forced the fluid out, you see. So when he pressed this, it would come out. He had this long needle. And he would start with the skin, and after he'd get through the incision, he'd start inside near the solar plexus. And he did all his work on local.
He was doing gastrectomy primarily. Was that the big operation?
Gastrectomy and gastrointestinal was the big operation. Yeah, that was mostly that. And he was a pretty good technician. Lurice was a good technician when it came to the sympathectomy. Otherwise, I mean, when he did a gastric resection, it was very poorly done.
You describe his incision for sympathectomy?
Yeah, he to show you, you know, he made a half moon incision like that. It was ridiculous in a way. You remember, I described it as best done with a little small transverse incision. You didn't have to cut any muscle. But he would cut the muscle, you see. And he would get a lot of exposure, no question about it. But a lot of it wasn't necessary. You didn't have to have all that kind of exposure to get to the lumbar chain. But once he got it, you see, he didn't do that. Either Kuhnlein or Young or Fontaine would make the incision, and they would close it. He'd come in when they had the thing exposed, and then he would start doing the technical work of removing the sympathetic chain. And he would do it in a very precise, technical way, you know. Not after a while, I would do it. In fact, I developed, remember, scissors for it, special scissors.
Well, those were extensive sympathectomies in that era.
Oh, yeah.
You markedly abbreviated the operation, as I recall.
I did, because if you remember in the article that I wrote about it, I said you didn't need to go all the way up that high, you see, because the major portion that you wanted was the sympathetic control over the vessels from halfway the thigh down. So there was no need to go up that high to get it. And even for the cervical, you know, I modified the sympathectomy for the cervical dorsal area so as to avoid having the having the effect upon the eye, you know, the drop in the lid.
I don't know if people realize, but you did a number of operations for venous disease using sympathectomy.
Oh, yeah. Sure.
Of course, with Larish, I think you published a paper on scleroderma.
Yes, that's right. Yeah.
So that was a primary arterial.
That was exactly, and that did stimulate me, no question about it, in the arterial field, and also in the sense of doing something in the vascular area, you see. But I think the greatest stimulus after that came from the technical development of arteriography and the bypass principle concept. And why nobody ever thought of bypass principle before that, to do it, I mean, when this fellow Jaeger thought of it and described it, you see? And yet nobody did it until Kuhnle actually did it. And Kuhnle didn't know about Jaeger, you know? I asked him about it later. He was very surprised to find out about Jaeger.
Yeah. Arteriography initially was quite toxic, wasn't it? They were using sodium iodide, I believe, initially.
Oh, yes.
So it was not something that was...
No, you're quite right. But you know what is interesting about arteriography, historically, is that within a year after Rentgen discovered the X-ray, you remember that was in 1895, within a year after that, two German scientists performed an arteriogram. And what they did, they did get a cadaveric hand, and they injected the radial artery with a radio opaque material, I've forgotten the nature of it now, and made a beautiful arteriogram of the arteries of the hand. And that was in 1896, 1 year later. Now, after that, arteriography went through a long period of research to develop a radio opaque material that was not non-toxic. And you remember in this country, well, let's go back to Europe. In Europe, there were two Portuguese. One was a neurosurgeon who developed the first arteriogram for the head, the cerebrum and cerebral vessels. And the other was Dos Santos, who was the father of Sid Dos Santos, you know, and was a professor of surgery there. Now, he was a great friend of Larish's. So he used to come and visit Larish, and his son, Sid Dos Santos, was in Larish's clinic same time I was, same year. So we got to be great friends. And I heard his father tell this story on several occasions. And then I visited him before his father died in Lisbon. And he showed me the first abdominal aortogram that he did, which was the first abdominal aortogram ever. And he tells the story that he went to Paris for the French Surgical Academy meeting, which, you know, was the top surgical meeting. And he presented it. And they virtually ran him out of town, because they said it was absolutely unnecessary, unethical to do something like that, you know, on a human being, possibly toxic. And what good was it? Think of that. Isn't that incredible?
That sure is.
You see? It just shows the timing wasn't ripe for it. But it had a very important effect, because as time went on, more people began to recognize that arteriography was useful. And so the Germans, particularly, the German scientists, because I've researched this, the German scientists were most responsible for developing the radiopaque substance that ultimately came to be used more routinely. You remember that all kinds of iodides were used. And the fellow at Vanderbilt, to name
Thorotrast, I think.
Yeah, they use Lapidol, Thorotrast, yeah. Very toxic.
Well, now, you came back then from Europe and, of course, joined the faculty at Tulane.
Tulane, yeah.
You want to comment on that experience? That was a very productive period for you.
It was for me, because a number of things were happening about that time. Everett Graham had done the first successful resection of a the lung, pneumonectomy. Well, that of course opened the field of thoracic surgery tremendously. And it brings up another very interesting, you might say, philosophical concept in medicine, clinical medicine, and surgery particularly. The first successful case is extremely important. Not the unsuccessful. I don't care, you know, what it is, maybe very innovative, but if it's unsuccessful, it doesn't have an impact. Let me just give you an illustration. Let's take ligation of the patent ductus. I mean, Gross did the first successful. Nobody remembers the people who did it before. There were a number of people who did it before, but they were all unsuccessful, you see? And even in coronary bypass, for example, Dave Sapperson did the first clinical case. I think it's 61 or 2 or 3, something like that. But it was unsuccessful. It had no impact, you see? But it's that first successful. Same way with aneurysm a number of people had tried to do aneurysm before. It was unsuccessful. It's that first successful case that makes a big difference.